Hello, welcome to this series on Bandgap References. My name is Ray Barnett. I have a website, nanoanalog.com. I did a little artwork here, sketched out the Brokaw cell, so I'll get into some details about this a little later. We are going to talk about this little loop here called the PTAT loop. We're going to talk about how you can create a PTAT voltage here and sum it with a diode voltage here to a band gap, approximately the band gap of silicon here, a little bit higher, and produce a nice stable voltage reference. So welcome to this series, and we'll get started. So before I get into the details of the band gap, I just want to explain why we would have voltage references on the chips. So here's a power supply I'm calling VDD and a ground VSS. And this is typically supplied by some sort of DC converter or a battery. Maybe that's the easiest way to think about. So let's say we have a 1.55. I think that's the voltage of a AA battery. And this battery is going to run our chip, but as you draw current from the battery, heavy current, this voltage will drop because the battery has a resistance to it. But also over time, this voltage drops and degrades. That's why your batteries die. So this voltage is decreasing over time with use. It's only got so much storage here. So this is decreasing over time in use, and we want to create a voltage reference on chip that is stable over this voltage. So we don't want to just, you know, take this voltage and divide down, create this. That's typically not how it's done if you have any circuits that require accuracy. So, you know, if I draw a chip here, and let's say, we had a microphone input and a amplifier and an A to D converter. And maybe part of this is a microprocessor controlling the ADC, and the ADC is feeding signals here, and we're writing firmware code here to control this system. All of these things need some sort of precision reference. Also, if we come in with, this could be a USB line of 5-volt. So we might actually have a DC to DC converter, which converts the 5 down to something low, like 2 volts with high efficiency. So we don't just divide the signal down. We use a converter that has high efficiency to convert this down. This could be a 12-volt car battery running the system. So who knows? There's all kinds of applications. Essentially, clear this out here. So the point is that we got something here that droops. We got a supply here that has noise, and we don't want that noise to get on here. And so we need a stable voltage reference. So chips typically have a VREF block and a IREF block to run currents, stable currents on the chip, and then stable voltages. So that is why we're going to talk about band gaps and why band gap references are important. They're to produce this stable voltage. Okay, now I'll get into the basic structure of the band gap voltage generator. What I'm showing here is a constant current source coming from VDD running into a diode-connected NPN transistor. So we have a base emitter voltage VBE here. If I plot VBE versus temperature, we'll see a negative temperature coefficient, minus 1.2 millivolt per degree C. I've seen numbers minus 2.2 millivolt per degree C, anything in between. I'm sure there's other numbers as well. Kind of depends on the process that you're looking at. So what we're going to do is, in series with this, we are going to put another voltage, which we're going to create somehow, but we're going to create a proportional to absolute temperature, that's PTAT here, a voltage PTAT, VPTAT. And the voltage here is our reference. It's the sum of the VBE and the PTAT. And the PTAT has a positive temperature coefficient. And when you weight these two properly and sum these two voltages, you'll get something up here that's relatively flat over temperature. So not only that, but when you go through the heavy math, basically you start with the band gap of silicon extrapolated at 0 degrees Kelvin, and the published value, that's 1.22 volts. So at a lot of times you'll see the band gap of silicon at 1.11 or something, somewhere around that, and that's actually at 300 Kelvin. The math that you go through here, you use the 0 degree Kelvin value, which is 1.22. Add to that, there's a term here, which is some factor here, M's dependent on the process. This turns out to be maybe 2 or 3, and then this is the thermal voltage, which is also a physical constant, KT over Q, which is about 26 millivolt at room temp. So it's a couple, 2 to 3 KT over Qs, 26 millivolts, so maybe 75 millivolts over the 1.22, or possibly 50 millivolts. So I think there's been published numbers down to 1.2 here, so it could be just a fraction of a thermal voltage here. The original Bandgap paper, I believe, had it flat at 1.25, and there's a lot of... I've seen papers at 1.2, so that's this voltage here. It's called the magic voltage. It's the voltage at which it's temperature stable, and it's usually just a little bit above this number here. So that's kind of the basics, and we'll get into more details next. I'm going to now do a just quick derivation of the PTAT loop. So what I'm showing here is a bipolar transistor here, area of 1, and then an area of A times bigger here, and resistor R1. Right now I'm going to assume that we have equal currents coming in to both of these transistors, and I'll show later how we're going to do that, but for now we're going to assume that, and we're going to write a loop equation around this. It's pretty straightforward. So I'll call this Q1, this Q2. So you know, coming up from ground here, this voltage is just VBE1, and I'm going to set that equal to this voltage here, which is VBE2 minus I'm going to assume the I1, same collector and emitter, and so we have a high beta for the transistor. So this will be, I'll just call it I times R1. And so, and actually that's a sum. So it's this VBE plus this drop is on this side, the right-hand side. I'm going to take the VBE2 over here by subtracting both from both sides. So I get VBE2 is equal to I times R1. Now these VBEs we're going to write as, so the thermal voltage, VT is KT over Q, and it's about 26 millivolts at 300 degrees Kelvin. So, and there's actually a VT is actually N. There's an N factor in here too. And N's usually, we're going to assume it's equal to 1. So we've got VT natural log of the collector current, which I'm going to just call I1, and the saturation current of Q1. So I'll call that IS1, minus thermal voltage times natural log of I1 again. It's running the same current. And then this is A times IS1. So the saturation current of this device, since its emitter area is A times bigger, is A times that of this one. So I write the same variable there. And then there's a property in natural logs where you can bring this term into here and flip it when you take the difference between two natural logs. So it is equivalent to this I1 IS1 times, and we're going to flip this A times IS1 over I1. So you can see the I1s cancel, the IS1 cancel, and we get VT natural log of A. And it's really NVT. I'll go ahead and leave that in there, even though we said it's 1. And that's equal to I times R1. And then over here we can solve for I, because we want to know what I is. So it's NVT natural log of A all divided by R1. So this so now we have to choose a value for A. So original Brokaw paper has A equal to 8. It's convenient that the natural log of 8 is pretty close to 2. So essentially we have 2 times VT. We have a reference that we've built in this loop here. When we force these two equal, we get a reference here that's about 2 times the thermal voltage, 26 millivolts, times N, which is about 1. So it's about 52 millivolts. And then natural log of 8 isn't exactly 2 even. So and then if you get an N factor a little bit, like 1.02 or something, usually this comes out to be 54 millivolts. So sometimes I'll use 52, sometimes I'll use 54. It's more likely to be 54. So I'm going to show 54 millivolts over R1. Now this is at room temperature, because the VT is proportional to Kelvin temperature. So this is a what we call IPTAT, and it's proportional to absolute temperature. So it's effectively what you can do is you can write this, and then if you want to modify this over temperature, you're going to write something like, so at room temp, this is the equation. So we can multiply this 54 millivolts times R1, and we're going to multiply it by, let's see, the T, might take me a second here to get this. So this is room temp. This would be the temperature that we're at. I guess it's just that. So when T is equal to room temp, which is 300 Kelvin, that becomes 1 and we get 54 millivolts. When it's, let's say, 400 degrees Kelvin, which is 127 degrees C, then we have a 4/3, which is about 1.33, so 30% higher this voltage is. So this voltage here, when you plot it versus temperature, and we do 300 degrees Kelvin here, we'll have, and actually if this is 0 Kelvin, it goes to 0. The voltage literally will go to 0, to absolute 0. And this is going to be our 54 millivolts. Of course, when you drop it across a resistor R1, then we convert the voltage to a current. And that's, I'm talking about the PTAP voltage here, but the current in here is the PTAP voltage over R1. So that's the basics of the PTAP loop. So I will get into a little more detail about diodes, because we're going to create, we got a PTAP current here, we're going to figure out how to use this to create a PTAP voltage, which really we had right here, but we're going to figure out how to scale that and add it to the diode. I will now talk about the temperature dependency of the diode a little bit. So I'm showing here a constant current coming in to a diode connected NPN transistor. Again, it's representing our diode. Let's see, I'm going to sketch this bandgap PTAT plus diode on a Kelvin. So this is temperature in Kelvin. And this is voltage. I'm going to say, okay, I've got 300 Kelvin here, which is room temperature, 27 degrees C, let's say. VGO, we've already said, I'm going to just call that 1.22. The band gap of silicon extrapolated to 0 degrees Kelvin. To make the math simple, again, what I'm doing here is kind of just a rough idea of what's going on. To keep the math simple, I'm going to pick the midpoint here at 0.61 volt and 1.22 volt here. So at this point, if we've got a diode voltage and we add it to a PTET voltage and we equalize, I'm going to say the diode voltage is going to be 0.61 and the PTET is going to be 0.61. They're going to sum up to be here and we get our nice temperature stable reference. So if we look at the PTET that we generated to get 0.61 here, it's going to start off at 0 degrees Kelvin at zero, and it's going to be a linear line straight through that point. So we've generated this with our PTET loop, and I'll show how we multiply up that 54 millivolt to get our 0.61 here. The diode at 0 degrees Kelvin actually sits at the band gap voltage of silicon, and then it comes down linearly. Now this isn't exactly right, there's a curvature to this that lowers this, but for now I'm just roughly showing what's going on. So the diode starts here, so by the time we hit 300 degrees Kelvin, I'm going to say the diode's sitting at 0.61 volt. So let's say we're at 0.61 volt here at 300 degrees Kelvin. And we add 0.61 and 0.61 and we get the 1.22, just to make the math easy. So we can, if, let's say, the diode voltage was running higher, let's say it was 0.8. And I think I'll change colors here to see if this works. The diode now is running at 0.8. And so, again, the diode starts here and comes down. And we only need to add a PTET voltage of 422 millivolts to this to get our band gap voltage. So this is actually going down. It was 0.61, and our PTET only needs to be 422. So, but you sum this and this, and you still get the 1.2, and it's still temperature insensitive. So either one of these designs is fine. Now, notice what happens to the diode millivolt per degree C here. So again, it's a negative temperature coefficient. So on the first curve, it's a certain slope. And this might be minus 2 millivolt per degree C, whereas this slope here is less. It might be minus 1.2 millivolt per degree C. So this is why you see so many different published values is really it depends on the current density you're running the diode at. And how big your area is. So I'm going to do some kind of rough calculations here just to show what I'm talking about. So I'm going to say I have a diode and the saturation current is 5 attoamps, which is 5 e to the 18, minus 18. And I'm going to plug this in to the diode equation, VT natural log of IC, and I'm going to say, okay, I'm going to run 54 nanoamps through this thing. I'm doing a low power design. So my collector current's 54 nano. And the saturation current down here is 5 atto. So punch in those numbers. And this is about 0.6. So the diode is sitting at 0.6 volt drop with 54 nanoamps. Now, let's say I needed a low noise design. I'll get into noise later, but noise, low noise typically means high currents. So if I were to multiply this current here, keep the diode exactly the same size, and go to 54 microamps. So that's a factor of 1,000, and every factor of 10, the diode voltage, with an N of 1, the diode voltage is going up 60 millivolts. So we got 3 factors of 10 for 1,000, so it's going up a sum of 360 millivolts, which is 180 millivolts. So our VBE in that case is 780. So, and the corresponding, like we said up here, the corresponding temperature, again, I'll maybe run through a couple numbers here, but the corresponding negative temperature coefficient is going to be lower because the slope's lower. And let me change my color back. So this is going to have a higher, maybe a 2 millivolt, minus 2 millivolt per degree C. We run the diode here. And likewise, if we go down to 5.4 nanoamps, so we drop it a factor of 10, then this voltage will go down 60 millivolts again, so that'll be 0.54. So it's all in how you design this, how big the diode is. We can scale this with diode size. We can throw a lot of area at this and really get an enormous value here, which is going to bring down the voltage quite a bit. It's going to increase the millivolt per degree C. But when we weight them, we're always targeting the 1.22 volt. So let me erase some of this. Let's see here. I'll go ahead and leave that sketch up. I might talk about it. And what I'm going to do next here is just compute some numbers. So the point, I erased that. 0.61 that we had here. So if we got 0.61, I want to compute the slope. So this is 300 degrees Kelvin, and I'm going from 1.22 to 0.61. So the delta Y, 0.61, that's what I have here, over 300. And that turns out to be just about minus 2 millivolts. So minus 2.03, so pretty close to minus 2 millivolts per degree C or degree K. They're the same step size, so usually we say degree C here. So if we do that thing where we run 1,000 less current in this, then that will drop 180 millivolts to 0.43 diode drop. Over 300, actually, if we drop it down here, then the delta Y is actually 1.22 minus 0.43, which is 0.76. So, scratch that out. We got 0.76 over 300 degrees Kelvin. We're expecting a bigger slope here as we lowered the current. And that is minus about minus 2.5 millivolts per degree C. So again, we've changed this. Likewise, if we go higher current, the diode voltage goes up and the slope gets less, and it's actually in this case it's 0.43 is the delta Y here. It's 1.22 minus the 7.6. So this comes out to be minus 1.4 millivolt per degree C. So we've come up with multiple numbers here just because we're running different currents. The main thing is whatever we design this to be, for whatever reason, we're going to sum the PTAT to get the 1.22, and all the math still works out. So again, you'll see different numbers published here. I just wanted to run through kind of a sketch a little bit graphically what's going on, and then explain a little bit about these different negative millivolt per degree C numbers. So I wanted to point out a few other things about the diode drop. I did say this was an I constant. In these band gap generators, it's running the I PTATs that we generated with the PTAT over R. So what does this mean? So we have our temperature, voltage, so at 300 degrees Kelvin here. The region that we're actually designing this diode in is in this area here. We're not designing it down here. We design ICs from, let's say, minus 40 degrees C, so this is kind of automotive range, to plus, 130, 135, 120, depending on kind of your market or whatever. So 0 degrees Celsius is going to be 273 Kelvin. So minus 40 is going to be 233. And then, if this is room temp at 127, 130 or 121 at 27 degrees Celsius, 127 would be 400 degrees Kelvin. So we're really operating from 233 to 400 degrees Kelvin. And that's where we're designing this thing. In this region, so I'm going to only draw the diode slope in this region now. If we run the PTAT increases, so the current's increasing over temp, which causes the voltage, when you increase the diode current, the voltage goes up. So it partially compensates for this, and you'll get less of a slope here. So it does flatten the slope when you run a PTAT. It typically is not that much. So if you're minus 2 millivolt per degree C with a constant current, you might be at minus 1.9 millivolt per degree C with a PTAT or something like that. It typically is not that big of a deal, but I did want to point that out. The other thing I wanted to... in addition to the PTAT current, the PTAT current is made by a PTAT voltage over a resistance, and this has its own temperature coefficient, which is going up with temperature. Typically, that's a high-value resistor. We have a positive temperature coefficient on that resistor. So again, that's a compensating effect as well. Plus, this varies. The resistors vary quite a bit on chip, say plus or minus 20%. So quite a bit of variation in the actual resistor. So the actual current is varying, plus or minus 20%, just due to the R alone. So we could trim that in as it varies over process. We'll talk a little bit about trimming the band gap overall. The other thing I wanted to say is if you have this diode connected NPN, it's actually got physical resistors here, the physical emitter resistance here, and the physical base resistance here. And you'll have a, depending on the beta, you'll have a base current into the base, and then of course you're flowing your I into the collector, and then the the collector current plus the base current is the emitter current, but basically the collector is the same as the emitter for our purposes. So you do have a heavy current flowing through a potential resistor here. These will modify then the PTAT loop equation. You might need to absorb these in the loop. One way to avoid this is to run very low current densities, and then these drops are negligible here and here. So I just wanted to point that out as well. We will get into the diode structure in the PTAT and how we sum it to the PTAT next. Okay, so the diode is actually in the PTAT loop already. It's this VBE right here. So that's a diode. We've equalized the current here and here. We said that this was a PTAT voltage over resistance producing a current. And then this current is equal to that current. So what we do is we sum this current and this current. So we got 2i here. And we drop it across the resistance here. And this is now, let's call this R1. And this R2. So the voltage drop across here is 2 of these currents that are PTAT over R1 times the resistance R2. So essentially have a ratio of resistors that match well and multiplied by 2 times our PTAT. So this is a PTAT voltage here. It's a voltage that has proportional to absolute temperature. One comment I wanted to bring out about the 8-to-1 ratio. I kind of joked about it being a nice round number. Ln of 8 is approximately 2. But one of the real reasons for doing this is, at least when you look at layout perspective, you need to match these devices. So here's a layout. We've got an emitter. This is a top view of the actual silicon device, collector and base. So it looks something like this from the top view. You have contacts here getting to the structure underneath. And you're really wanting to match. So we have a 1 here and an 8 here. These need to be well matched. So typically you use 8 physical devices here. You don't want to stretch this and create an emitter area by stretching the device this way. You want to replicate 8 of these. And then when we do common centroid layout, I'll discuss that in a second. Let me just draw what I'm talking about here. So there's an array, a box array of 9 devices here. And the center one here is going to be our Q1. And the Q2 over here is 8. And 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. So we've got one device in the center and 8 around it. And this is probably the biggest reason why we typically use an 8-to-1. Is actually you can do this layout arrangement. And then if there's a process gradient going across here, causing the saturation current of this device to be, it changes. So let's say this is going from high to low saturation current. So this would have a high saturation current, medium here, low here. But if you average the high and the low, then you get approximately the median. So a linear gradient here gets canceled by this common centroid configuration. So I did want to just point that out as is a good reason for using 8 devices here. I also wanted to point out that it's really the current density that's important. So some band gaps you could actually have the same device 1-to-1, but you can run I and 8i in a device here. And then you'll get the same VBE difference. So there's different ways to do it. It's the current density in these devices that's important. Okay, so now I'm going to expand this out and start to build the actual band gap reference. So we've got our PTAT loop, we've got our PTAT voltage here, we've got our diode voltage here set to 1.2 volts. So let's say we have a 2 volt supply coming in. What you need to do is you need to set this current equal to this current. And typically the way that could be done is you could, you wouldn't do this, but I'm going to just say you could diode connect this, and then whatever current you have going in here, this is that Widelar mirror, so you would get some current coming out of here, and you just have to put in the right current so that this current's the same current as that. So what you would often do is, I'm going to draw MOS structures here, so we're going to have some PMOS devices. You could do some kind of structure like this. This is not going to be a very good reference. You could potentially get this in the headroom of 2 volts. So this is a MOS VGS. So let's say we're on 0.13 micron process. Or let's do, 0.25 micron process. So we got a 2 volt supply here. So maybe this VGS you could set to be 0.7 volts. This is 1.2, so 1.2 and 7 here would give you 1.9. So that would actually keep this about 100 millivolts above the 1.2 here, so this point would be at about 1.3. So that's plenty of room to keep this device in the active region. You never want to get very low voltages across the collector to emitter. You know, you want to keep those 400 to 500 millivolts. So what does this circuit do? It takes the current here and it mirrors it here. So whatever I you have flowing here also gets mirrored here. So that's where you would get the two currents equal. Now there's all kinds of problems with this. One's the base currents here. You're going to subtract off of this current and you have a different current here. The bigger problem is, I didn't discuss this, but in this PTAT loop over here, you want to equalize those two collector voltages. It's actually very critical for the operation of the bipolar, that PTAT loop. You want this voltage to be the same as this voltage. Then you have to adjust this common base point. So you're not only equalizing the voltages here, but then you're going to have to equalize the currents. And equalizing the voltages is important in the PTAT loop here, because it assumes you're matching this device to this device, and if you don't equalize those, then you can have different, there's an output impedance effect here that causes a big error. And again, this is you're really trying to pinpoint this circuit into a very temperature stable reference, a predictable reference, and again you need to equalize the voltages here to do that.
All right, now I'm going to expand on the structure a bit. Again, going to draw the PTAT loop here, PTAT voltage, diode voltage. This time I'm going to draw a couple resistors here, R and R, going to our VDD. Again, we need some sort of amplifier here, A, to feed back to the base. And so what this structure is doing is it's equalizing the voltage here. The amp has a lot of gain. It's forcing these two points equal. And then since these two points are equal and they're across, they have the same matched resistor here and here, then the currents are equal. And that's what we wanted to get here. We wanted to get the collector voltages equal and the currents is equal. And then if we set all this thing up right to say 1.2 volts, we have our nice temperature, stable reference here. So the just some quick
design aspects here. So I think we said we'd do 5 meg here, 1 meg here approximately. And then if this is 1.2 volts here, then we want to keep this collector 1.2 volts or higher. You could probably actually go to 1 volt or higher, but for now I'm just going to say we have 0 volts between the collector and base. So we're going to keep that at 1.2 volts. For example, if we had a minimum supply of 2 volts, then we could drop 0.8 volts across this resistor here. And if you remember, this was 52 nanoamps, we said, about 50 nanoamps. So these are pretty big resistors, I think right around 16 megohm then each. So a lot of area is put in to do these very large resistors. Again, this is for a nano power design. So we're going to get into, you know, exactly how to do the A and the R's here, but, you know, I did want to point out, you know, if this varies up, say, 2.5, then both of these points will go up a half a volt, and the amp still works. It's forcing these two equal, and it'll force this 1.2 volts here. So if we change this value DC here, we should get, as long as this wiggle here is within the reaction time, which is the loop bandwidth of this loop, then the 1.2 will remain 1.2. We can vary this up and down, and this stays at 1.2. If we wiggle it very fast and the amp can't react, then we do get direct coupling to the 1.2 volt. So this would be power supply rejection, a power supply rejection issue. If we were concerned about that, if we're concerned about a fast wiggle on here showing up on a reference here, say it was used for audio, and all of a sudden you've got something, you know, banging away on the supply, creating that ripple, you don't want it to show up here and then be able to hear it. So again, there's audio is just one example. So ideally, you like to kind of separate out this and not have a direct path here at high frequencies, not even have a direct path here. So, you know, the Brocross cell actually does a bootstrap here to supply this from its own reference, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. So I'm going to talk about the bootstrapping technique. So bootstrapping comes from the term that you can pull yourself up by your own bootstraps, which is an impossible thing, but in circuits they have that terminology, and it basically means that we're going to supply a circuit with a reference that's generated from the same reference that it's supposed to be producing. So we can do this as long as we have a startup circuit, we kickstart it, and there's a way to get the whole system running. So again, if we had this amplifier here feeding back to the base, to give our, we originally said this was VDD, but now we're going to say we don't want that there. We want some method. So if this is let's say 1.2 volts here, if somehow we were to build some sort of offset of 0.8 volt here and feedback that to its own resistors, which we said had a 0.8 volt drop, if these were 16 meg, 1 meg, and 5 meg. You can't really do that. You have to have something coming from the supply. Ultimately, all the current comes from the VDD up here. So one way you could do it, though, is let's say you had a current source feeding all of this. And this current is much bigger than any current that this portion of the circuit wants to take. So let's say all of this portion of the circuit takes, I don't know, we said 102 nanoamps in this section here. And let's say the amp's another 100. So let's say we have 204 nanoamp. We'll just round it. 200 nanoamps there. And then we'll say we're going to bias this reference here with 50 nanoamps. So the total here, if we had a 250 nanoamp current source here, It could supply the whole circuit, plus it could supply this reference. And then if we do a good job at this current source, then you wiggle this node here, and again, you can provide better isolation to this point with a current source because it has a high output impedance. And also, depending on how you do it, you know, the capacitance from here to here is what couples in at high frequency. But it's better than just a direct connection. You can isolate it with another set of devices. So the Broca cell actually does this, and I can sketch out the full Broca cell next. So next I will sketch out the Broca cell. I just wanted to clarify on the, we had that current source of 250 nanoamps, and then 200 supplied kind of the core. And then I had this reference here, which had 50 nanoamp. I kind of drew that as flowing back into the circuit, but really there's a way to build this reference where that 50 nanoamp biases up what it takes to produce this voltage, and it actually flows to ground. So that was a little deceiving in that last picture. So I will start now with the Broca cell. So I'm going to build this up from scratch and talk about it as I go. So I start with the 8-to-1 ratio. Resistor here, resistor here. We've talked about all this already. So we have to equalize these two currents. So the Broca cell, I better leave myself some room here, has a emitter follower and a PNP current mirror here. And so this is the current mirror that matches this current and this current, and also forces these two voltages equal, and here's how it does that. So I'm not drawing what's connected up here yet. That's where the bootstrap's going to come in. So we've got a mirror here that mirrors the current from here to there. And then we've got, from here we've got kind of this fancy, I'm going to draw it a little different than the paper. They got a single emitter, dual collector device, but basically it looks something like this. It's just a simple mirror here. So this mirrors this current here and here. This is actually a level shifter that goes up one diode, up two diodes, up an IR drop, which is actually matching this IR drop, the degeneration resistor here. And then there's an NPN connected like a diode. And there's kind of a Darlington here, which is a follower and another follower. And then this is the final dividing resistor. So if we set this to 1.2 volts, if this R and this R is equal, you have the same current here and here, neglecting the base current. So this would be about 2.4 volts. So in the paper, this is set to 2.5 volts. So let me keep going here. There's another device here that basically biases up some current to run this top current source that we talked about in the bootstrap circuit. So this would come up into a degenerated current mirror PNP, and then this would dump into this whole string here. So this point here is the high gain node of the loop, and it's going up a diode, up another diode, up an IR, up another diode, and then down a diode, down a diode, down a diode. So there's three diodes down, three diodes up, plus the IR. This IR, the IR matches this IR here. Then this is where this jumpers over and produces the bootstrap. So you can see from the band gap, I didn't mean to connect that. To ground, the band gap 1.2 there. From the band gap there, we go up to 2.4, up a diode, up a diode, down a diode. Again, this is the bootstrap path here. This particular follower here is biased by that current there. And then this just goes to the rail. And then there is a JFET here for startup. So with the ground there. And so what this does is it provides a current into this path. And then once the whole thing gets up, this shuts off. And so why do we do that? Most of these bias circuits have two states, the zero state and the bias state. And you got to prevent from getting in the zero state. So for example, this loop here, that the by 8 device has an exponential, but then it's limited by this resistor, so it kind of has a linear effect at high. So here I'm plotting current versus voltage across this device here. This by 1 device doesn't take off as fast, but then once it does start taking off, it is a full exponential because there's no resistance in here limiting it. So you have a common point where the two currents are equal here, but they're also equal here at zero. So the circuit's liable to, you know, converge here and never get started up because it's perfectly happy. So you have to prevent that by supplying a current into the system, forcing this condition. So that's typical. So if you've studied analog circuits and references, this is a very typical condition here. Anyway, that's a quick run on the Brokaw cell. So next we'll get into some other aspects. Okay, so I wanted to go back to the Brokaw structure and talk about one thing I didn't talk about that they talk about in the paper. I'm showing the basic structure here, none of the messy circuitry up here. I'm showing it with a follower right here. So this you would set to 1.25 volts. So I've been using 1.2, but going forward I'll call this 1.25 just to be consistent. We have base currents here due to these two devices. You have two IB right here, and if you have a follower, it's just going to flow through that follower and it's not going to really cause an error. But in the paper, they multiply that voltage up. Let's say you wanted something higher than 1.25 volts. In fact, in the paper, if we set this to R here and this to R here, then we can get 2.5 here because the same current's flowing here as here. And so basically we have 1.25 volt drop here and 1.25 here, so they sum to 2.5. So in that case, the 2IB flows through here, and that does cause the output to go up, and then there's a way to compensate it by inserting kind of like what they would call an alpha comp resistor into the bipolars. So I'm going to draw, I'm going to cut this off here. I'm going to draw a resistor here. I think the paper probably calls that R3. And then essentially we have a base current flowing through this. And setting that resistor, you can read the paper. So typically it's a combination of the parallel combination of this device, and then some other terms with these that you're compensating. So there's a value for R3, but typically that's actually, then you tweak it in simulation, you tweak it in properly. And the reason you tweak it is because this is a 1 device and this is an 8 device. The intrinsic RB of this, let's say it's RB here, this has an intrinsic RB of RB over 8 because there's 8 in parallel. But they have the same base currents flowing through. So typically those two, the mismatch in those, are kind of absorbed in setting this as well. So I just wanted to point that out about the Brokaw cell. You can go to the paper and read more about this, but typically that resistor is just tweaked in. Okay, I wanted to talk a little bit about models. If you create this circuit and you fine-tune it and tweak it in simulation, get it just perfect, it's really only as good as your models. And it's sometimes those models are not correct. They weren't designed to be to get all the parameters to be accurate. You can play around with various parameters and still get matching to devices, but when it comes to this band gap, getting that temperature, zero TC, everything, modeled correctly in that takes some special modeling. So hopefully your process group has done that for you, but again, just be cautious about that. So a lot of times, if you're doing a band gap for the first time on a chip, you're gonna have some sort of trimming just because maybe the models aren't correct. You're gonna want to trim this. You're gonna want to trim it to the zero temperature coefficient. If you come out and you have a design that looks like this, you're going to want to give it a little more PTAP voltage down here by including some more series resistance here. That will shift the whole curve up like this as you trim, but it will flatten it out. And eventually, if you go too much, then it will be like this. So you're trying to target this, but that might not be the voltage you thought you designed to. Maybe in simulation, you're 1.22. is this, and then when it comes out, it is 1.22, but the curve looks like this. So you need to trim it up to 1.24 to get it correct. So you got to decide what's important to you. But effectively, if you're trimming here, you're shifting that whole curve up by adding more PTAT or less PTAT. You can do a trim here as well. So there's different arguments for doing at different places. If you had a multiplying up type network, then you could trim here to get the flatness, the weighting correctly, and then trim either here or here, more than likely down here. We like to usually trim near ground because you're doing this with MOS devices. You would typically have a fixed resistor and a bunch of series resistors, and then you might be shorting them out with various MOS devices in a digital code here. So again, you might trim with flash memory in your system. You might have EEPROM actually available on your chip. You could trim it and store it right on your chip. So these are non-volatile memories that you can use to trim the band gap. But I just wanted to talk a little bit about trimming, because this is actually very common these days. You usually have flash in your system. A lot of these analog chips have the double EEPROM. So eventually I'm going to shift over and talk about some other low-voltage structures besides the Broca cell. I did want to cover noise on the Broca cell, because that kind of is useful in all the structures, but I did want to talk just in general here. So again, I have a VREF. We're going to say this is a 1.25 volt reference. The noise on this reference that's produced by this, so I'm not talking about the noise from VDD coupling in there, but this circuit produces its own electronic noise, and it's going to show up here. And so there's certain cases where that's important. Let's say you had a 1.25 volt system, and this was running a reference for A to D converter, and this was 16 bit. So 16 bits about 2 to the 16's a little over 65,000. So let's see, you divide, 1.25. By 65,000, and the level on that in here would be about, looks like 19 microvolts step. So you're trying to resolve, if this is the reference going into the ADC, depending on the structure of the ADC, it might be twice this, but basically you might be trying to resolve 19 microvolts for an analog signal coming into this, and you're trying to produce a digital word that's, 16 bits, so 16 bit output. You're only as good as your reference. If the reference is moving around with a noise of 200 microvolts, then that's basically shifting all these levels, especially here towards the top. But if it's in the middle here, it's, and this shifts up 200 microvolts, this level shifted up 100 microvolts. if your analog signal wasn't changing at all, your code would change by, you know, if it's only 19 microvolts per step, it could be 20 or 5 LSBs just without the analog changing at all. So you have a 200 microvolt step here, and maybe you get 5 LSB change out here. So that's kind of unacceptable in a real high performance system. Another one that I've ran into that's quite important is in PLLs. They need to be pretty low noise on a lot of applications. And in order to run a VCO, typically you have an I reference, and that I reference comes from a VREF, and you basically take a VREF and you take it over a resistance and produce a current that's basically this VREF over R, kind of as your basic reference here. And then the VCO part of it is going to modulate that to produce a different frequency. But this is, it's very important to have a low flicker noise to this VCO, and that's directly affected by the flicker noise of this VREF. So low frequency noise here could be very important into the spectral content out here. You might have this varying around quite a bit due to the flicker noise of the reference here. So I'm going to get into the Broca structure and talk a little bit about the noise sources there. And not a whole lot of math. Some, but more intuitive look. Now I'm going to talk about a little bit more on noise and some filtering concepts here. So again, we have our voltage reference here. Here I've kind of drawn a XY plot, noise spectral density, microvolt per square root of hertz versus frequency. So just pick some numbers here. Let's see. So your typical spectrum is going to look something like this. So this is the flicker noise of the reference. It's a 1 over F in power. So it's square root of F in voltage RMS noise, increasing as you get lower and lower frequency. So right here at 1 hertz, let's say you design this reference and you have a spectral density of, let's say, 20 microvolt per root hertz right here. You then build a system. If you, this is a log scale, of course, 1 hertz, 10 hertz, 100 hertz. If you go all the way up to 1 megahertz, eventually this flattens out to a flat spectral density, but the total RMS noise here, you have to integrate this spectrum. So you do an integral of the spectrum, and then you're going to come up with a RMS value. So if this were flat, so let's say we had a 10 nanovolt per root hertz flat spectrum, and we were integrating, say we could bandpass this, again here I'm talking about an amplifier, not a reference, but let's say we bandpass this from, 1 kilohertz, and it was flat already, to 1 megahertz. So the total bandwidth here, we would take, the square root of that bandwidth, and that would, that's in square root hertz, that cancels the square root hertz, multiply that by the 10 nanovolts, and that would actually be the RMS value of the noise. And so you multiply that by, 5 or 6, and that would be the peak value. So I won't compute the numbers there, but basically you need to integrate that noise. When you have flicker noise, you're integrating and you're capturing, it's getting noisier in spectral density as you get lower and lower frequency. So for example, if you were to integrate this from 1 hertz to, say, 0.01 hertz, you might get a value, the spectral density here is 20 microvolts, you might get a value more like 45 microvolts RMS in that bandwidth. If you integrate all the way out to 1 megahertz way out there, You're going to get an enormous value of, 635 microvolt RMS, for example. So, if you just let this reference sit there without a filter on it, it's as far as the noise is outputting in the bandwidth of the system. If this can go out to a megahertz, it's going to pass all that noise. You could potentially have, 635 microvolts here, whereas if you could filter it down at 1 hertz, you'd only have 45. And this reference is, it's useful at DC, so we don't care about having a wide bandwidth here. It's a DC, so we'd prefer to filter that component. So one way to do it on some structures, you can just use an external cap here of large value, say a 1 microfarad directly on this. A lot of A to D converters would use, especially if they're, high precision, they would use an external cap here to produce that. You might even put, a resistor here to produce a low-pass function to only get a certain value. You could integrate these on chip. Of course, that's not 1 microfarad. If it's on chip, it might be, 100 picofarad, and then you'd get as big a resistor here as possible. So, again, you only want to capture as much noise. You want to capture as little noise as possible. So you do want to filter this out here. And since it's a DC reference, you don't care about what it's doing at high frequencies. It's bad to let that noise through. So you try to filter as much as possible. But that's a technique for getting the noise on this down. This is one of the most often overlooked part of A to D converter design. Is everybody who's designed this ADC assumes there's a great VREF with zero noise, and they'll design the whole thing for that. And somebody else has designed the VREF, and they know nothing about the requirements. You stick them together, and then all of a sudden this is not performing well at all. So that is just a little bit on filtering and band gaps. And now I'm going to focus a little bit on the noise internal here. Now I'll look at the noise sources in this whole structure. So I've kind of drawn the structure out here with a lot of gaps in it because I wanted to kind of show where various noise sources are. First of all, these NPNs, they have noise source. I'm not going to get into all the noise sources, but basically there's a thing called little RE over 2. It's a fictitious resistance that's based on collector current shot noise referred to the base, plus an intrinsic RB of the device. So we have some noise resistance associated with this device. And that noise you can either place here or you can place in the base right here. It doesn't matter. You get the same effect in the analysis. So so I'll put a noise source here, and the noise sources are signified by kind of a voltage bubble, but with a, a star in the middle. So likewise, we would have one here due to that device, but also this resistor here, which I think we're calling R1, has its own noise source, but it's indistinguishable in properties of transfer function from this device here. They're both in series. So, of course, they're different values. This one is 4KT times R1, and that's the voltage noise squared. So you take the square root of that to get the RMS value. But that's resistor noise theory. Same thing here. We have 4KT times this fictitious resistance that we came up with over here. Fictitious and part of its physical here. So you compute all those, and then you have a noise source here. So these are the important noise sources. You also have noise sources due to the load resistors, noise source due to the amp, input amp. So I'm completing the structure here. These are all the important ones. This feeds to this center here. Again, this noise source here you can certainly move that into here, and it doesn't really do anything as far as the change the analysis. What I did want to talk about is once you put this structure together, there's some pretty defined relationships in between saying, okay, if we have a noise source here, how does this noise source transfer into a change in the final output? So this noise analysis of the band gap is quite different because you're looking for the common mode, voltage output here change due to often a noise source that's in differential with the structure. But the real important thing is what's the noise out here? So when I wiggle this noise source here, what's the transfer function from here to this output? So I'm not going to go through all the derivations. There's some, it's very interesting if you go through the math. You can relate a lot of these resistances to multiplying factors of the thermal resistance, little re, which is VT over IC. And again, that's our 26 millivolt. So this resistor here turns out to be twice that. And then this one's, 10 to 20 times that. So you can relate them all to kind of this little RE parameter here. And then a lot of things start canceling and you get direct transfer functions. So independent of what this resistor is, the transfer function from here to the output, for example, is about 1 volt. If you wiggle this right here, it directly couples up through this diode connection effectively right on to the base here, which is the final voltage. Now, not all of them are that simple, but basically this has a 1 volt per volt type transfer function. There's some different ones. The transfer function here is on the order of 12 volt per volt. The transfer function here is on the order of 13. These are about the same, but you get over 10 gain from this element to the band gap here. And then this particular element also has a transfer function that's independent of R. Now the noise source is dependent upon R, but the transfer function from here to here, which is what you need to first, you compute what the value is of the noise source here, but then you have to transfer it to the band gap, and you do each one of these separate, and you have to sum the squares and take the square root to get the final RMS noise here. So the transfer function here on this particular one, I think, is on the order of 1.4 volt per volt, something like that. But the very interesting thing is you can change, to set this up, once you set up the ratios of R's, if you change things, you have to scale. So if you double this resistance here, you're going to have to double that resistance to hit the band gap voltage. But the transfer functions of these noise sources don't stay the same. So that's the 13, the 12, the 1, and the 1.4. So there's a lot of math that goes into that. Those are just some rough numbers. And then I did want to point out that a lot of designs, you might, like if you did the Brokaw structure and you didn't have the PNPs to work with, you might be using MOS devices up here. And so the MOS device, again, you might be feeding back. You might be just actually feeding back to this point to adjust. I guess I gotta erase this. Different things you can do here is let's say you can diode connect this and diode connect that, and then have an amplifier that feeds back to MOSFETs here. Well, the MOSFETs are notorious for their high flicker noise. So this flicker noise current source can be quite, it's usually the dominating effect in these type. So what I like to do is stay away from the MOS devices if possible, until you get past your gain, and then, you know, you could use MOS devices in here. One way to do that is using the resistor loads instead of the MOS up here. On the low voltage structures, sometimes you just got to deal with the MOS. And to get low noise, you do a couple things. You increase the power consumption, the currents. For flicker noise, it's pretty independent of the current. Basically, you got to increase area. So we'll get into that with the low voltage structures, but there's some equations I might throw together on this, but I just wanted to, in general, relate these different gains here. There was a couple things in the last section. I was being loose with the terminology, and I was throwing out RMS. So essentially, we have a 4KTR type noise. So this is a resistor noise, and this is the power is 4KTR. Spectral density. I was saying RMS, but essentially the when you take the square root of the power, you get the voltage noise itself. But then you do need to multiply or integrate. If your spectral density is flat, then you just need to multiply by the square root of the bandwidth to get the RMS. So just wanted to clarify that. If it has a frequency response to it, then you need to integrate the function. You need to weight it, all these areas. It's not just a flat line, so you can just take the bandwidth. You have to actually integrate the function. And take the square root, and then that will give you the final RMS value. So just wanted to point that out. Okay, I'm going to go through some of these noise transfer functions. I think it'll be useful to see how I do some of this. So I have the Broadcast cell here, and first thing I'm going to do, so let me just talk about, I'm looking at AC models now. I'm gonna try to figure out when I have a noise source in here, VN, and this thing's in its feedback loop here, and I wiggle VN, how much of it shows up on VB, because that's gonna be the noise transfer function. And so I'll need to compute this noise source and then multiply by that transfer function, and that's how much shows up on the VB here. Typical hybrid Pi model is shown here. So RPi, base, emitter, collector, GM, VPi, VPi here, RO, very much like a MOS small signal model, except for this RPi, which is beta little RE. I'm actually not going to use that. It'll get too complicated, and I can get what I want using a very simple model, just to kind of show the transfer functions. I'm going to use a model. It's similar to what's called a T model in the bipolar, but I simplify it even more. Basically, I'm going to say, okay, this is Q1 here. I've got the base, and I've got an ideal buffer, and then I've got a little RE resistance here to the emitter. And this little RE is VT over IC. And, of course, that's our 26 millivolt at room temp over the collector current. Same thing for Q2. They're running the same current, so the little REs are the same. So I'm going to draw that one over here, the base of Q2 here. Little RE here. So the emitter of Q2 is here. And that would be this point here. And R1, though, we already said this is approximately the drop across this is 2VT. And 2VT over R1 is I. We already said this. And now I'm going to rearrange this and solve this for R1. So VT over I, which is really IC, is equal to R1. So this is little RE, same one up here. So essentially R1 is approximately equal to 2RE. So I'm going to put a 2RE resistor here. And then R2, I had said 5 mega ohm. I'm going to change that to 6 going forward. Once you tweak that cell up in a particular technology, you know, you'll get different. This value is totally dependent on where you bias the diode, like I talked about earlier. Right now, I'm going to just call it 12RE because it's just a scaled version of this. And it's helpful to put them all in terms of RE. So sometimes we'll call this R2, sometimes we'll call it 12RE, depending on the analysis here, and I'll show you why. So this is kind of the model that we're going to use to derive noise transfer functions. These two bases are connected together. Before we stick in a noise source here and figure out what that does to wiggle B, I find it useful to first find out a different transfer function that we'll make use of for all the noise analysis. And that is, when you put in a AC, again, this is an AC model, base excitation here, what delta I is going to produce in here. And the delta I will be this I1 minus the I2 here. So that's our delta I. So we're going to find out our output will be delta I over an input of VB. And we'll come up with some equation here. And then we can invert this and say VBE over delta I is equal to 1 over whatever we come up with there. And then we can multiply each side by delta I. Then what we're going to do is we're going to take a noise source here, and we're going to figure out what delta I is produced by that noise source, and we're going to plug it in here. So this is going to be replaced by VN times some equation. And then we will bring the VN over here. So we'll get something like this times some equation. This will be VB over VN. So this is what we're ultimately after, is when we wiggle this, what's the effect at the basis? And let me erase some of this. And then I'll show some of the methods I get to get the VB to delta I transfer function. So we have VB, and these are tied together, and so we have RE in parallel with 3RE, and then I'm going to go ahead and call that 12RE down here, but we can also call it R2. So this is actually 3/4 RE when you do that parallel combination. So I'm going to call this VMID here, and so VMID is the voltage divider created by the 12RE plus the 12RE plus 3/4 RE. That's that voltage divider from here to there. So when you do this, you're going to get that VMID is the base voltage times 0.94. Again, for the 12RE. So depending on your design, that might vary a little bit, but it's basically 0.94. So that is the current right here. And, that is the voltage here, and then the current there is going to be VMID divided by, I'm just going to call it R2 now. So we'll get R2 here, but it's also equal, we could replace that with 12RE. But for now, I'm just going to say that the current right here is equal to this term right here. So now that current splits here and here. And this is RE and this is 3RE. So the split is 3:1. So 75% of it goes there, 25% of it goes there. So when you take the difference between those two, the delta I is going to be 0.5 times the I down here. And that I down here we already said was this. So we end up with our kind of final equation. And what we're going to get here is let me erase some of this here.
And so we're going to get delta I is equal to delta I is equal to 0.5, that's the half, times the 0.94 over R2 times VB. And we're going to bring the VB over here. And so this is our transfer function we've been looking for. And we're going to write that up in the corner up here. And it's going to be delta I over VB is equal to 0.47 over R2. Likewise, we can flip it. VB over delta I is equal to R2 over 0.47. This is the one we're going to use, the flipped version. Okay, so now how are we going to use that? That's kind of messy. I'm going to go ahead and redraw this. Okay, so got RE. I've got my 3RE. And now I'm going to call this 12RE. And these are tied together. And I want to know when I put a noise source here, and we can put in these buffers, but it doesn't matter. How's that going to show up on the bass? So the first thing I want to know is the V noise to delta I, and then I'll use this equation and find out what the V noise to VB is. Okay, so actually the first thing I'm going to do is pick this side. I'm going to pick the noise source here, VN. So I'll erase that. So I want to look at this VN here, and I'm going to simplify it and say, okay, looking here, I see RE and 12RE here. I'm going to neglect the current flowing in that path just to simplify it even further. So when I have a voltage here, again, this is an AC analysis, so these are 0 volt, ground. I put in my wiggle here, and it produces a current in this loop. That's the total resistance, 3RE plus RE, so we have 4RE. And the voltage divided by the resistance is equal to the current. And that's, doesn't matter direction. This is a noise source. So I'm going to say that's our I1. But the same current flows out I1 and pulls into this other side, I2. So the delta is actually twice this current. So we got 2 times VN over 4RE, so basically we've got VN over 2RE is equal to delta I. Okay, so we're going to make use of this and make use of this over here. And so we've got VB. And delta I now is VN over 2RE, but I can just flip that up here, 2RE there. And then equal to this here, R2 over 0.47. And then I bring this RE to this side. And then here's where it's useful to put in the 12RE here, because I can get the REs to cancel. 2RE, and then the REs cancel. And then this is about, it's half times 2, so that's about 1. So we can already tell it's about 12. But when you count for that, it's 12.7. So, and that's a volt per volt, and that's the transfer function. When I put one unit of noise here, I see 12.7 units show up on VB. So that's the transfer function I was talking about earlier. So if we quickly kind of look at the other side, let's see, I'm going to erase this, and I'm going to look at the noise source here now, get my pen back. So this is RE. I'm going to look at the noise source here now. So this VN, and this time I'm not going to do that, because this is 3RE and that's 12RE. So if I rewrite kind of this, this is what it looks like. I've got my noise source here. I got RE here.
I've got three RE in parallel with 12 RE, which is like 2.4 RE. So this produces a current that's V noise over the 2.4 RE plus the RE here. So 3.4 RE. That's my current flowing here. And that current flows here, but it splits. 0.8 of it goes here because of this ratio here, and 0.2 of it goes here. So I only see 0.8 here, so I don't double my current. Like before, I double my current, I actually multiply this by 1.8 because it's the one unit I have on this side plus a 0.8 unit that I have on this side. So this is my total delta I here. And then, let's see, I can use this equation again. So I've got VB over delta I, which now I'm saying is VN, times 1.8. And then I'm going to bring this to the top. 3.4 RE. And I'm going to set that equal to this again, R2 over 0.47. And again, it's helpful to write this as 12 RE. And then I bring this over on this side, so I got a 3.4 RE here. And then a 1.8 factor here, and that eliminates this and this. And again, I have my transfer function. The RE's canceled. This turns out to be 13.5. So the gain from here to the base is 13.5. The gain from here to the base is roughly 12.7 or 12.5. I neglected this and that analysis. But so they're about the same. They're over 10, just over 10. But it shows the need to reduce these noise sources because there's a gain of 10 from here to the base, which is where we're wanting, this is our reference we're producing. So that's where the noise is important. So likewise, let me erase this. So the next step would be to look at the noise source. Get my pen back. The noise source in here. And again, let's see. So, yeah, when we do this, I said before it's about a gain of 1. You can go through the math. Essentially, what you do is you, again, you put these in parallel. So you're going to have a VB, you're going to have a RE, a 3RE. I think we said that was a 2.4RE. Total parallel there, and then 12 RE, and then we put so again it's AC, so we treat these as the same node. Put our voltage in here divided by the total resistance is 12 plus our 2.4 RE. That's the total resistance in this loop, and that produces our current I, and then that I splits the 50%. So again, we can use that 50% technique where 0.75 went here, 0.25 went here. And again, that gets us our delta I, and then we use this again to get the final equation. And you'll see that VB for the VN of R2, the noise here, is about equal to 1 volt per volt. So that noise source only sees a gain of 1. And you can do similar things. This model here, this current really flows to the RL, so you can kind of do the same analysis with RL, figure out the load resistor, what the delta I is there, and use the same factor here to get that noise. I think I said when you do that it's like 1.4 or something like that. So again, all of these change slightly depending on your design, because this 12RE will change depending on the diode bias that you've chosen for your design. But these are rough numbers. Again, we're just wanting some rough numbers to help us with the... I'm going to now shift over and talk about some different structures. So we've already gone through the Broca cell pretty extensively here. So I think this was 1974, Analog Devices, Brokaw work there. Then in, I believe it was 99, Bamba et al. At Toshiba. So there were certainly many other structures in here, some CMOS-based ones in between these years, curvature correction, things like that. You know, I'm kind of skipping through quite a bit here. But the Bamba structure is quite often used for low voltage. It's kind of a current mode approach. It doesn't require, you know, the 1.25 volt plus headroom to fit this in. So if I were doing a 5 volt USB design and I, you know, had to run at 5 volt, I would use this structure. It is the least noisy. You get a very high voltage here. So again, noise relative to the value, percent noise relative to the value. The higher the value is, then the more noise you can have here for a percentage. So high reference value is useful. You can do that bootstrapping technique. You have lots of voltage to work with and get very good power supply rejection ratio out of this structure. This is still very useful for high voltage designs. But a lot of stuff done now, chips are low voltage. And so this Bamba structure, it's done with PMPs. I'm just going to show them as diodes. You can, you know, in CMOS, you can create a PMP kind of. It's got collector current to the substrate. So you're effectively diode connecting that PMP. Just going to show it like this. But the Bamba structure, you put resistors around these. So here again, back to our thing here. We have 1 meg here on the Brokaw cell. I think I've been saying 5 meg here, but it's probably more like 6, depending on once you tweak it in. These might be big, you know, 10 meg or something here. So if we have 1 meg here, this might be more like 13 meg. And you're still using an amplifier to lock these 2 points equal here and here. So the same loop equation around here as here is identical loop equation. Again, this is an 8-to-1 ratio. You're forcing these 2 points equal, and that allows you to write the loop equation. And then you're forcing the currents coming in equal. So often you'll, here's where you're using PMOS devices, say, and you have an amplifier that does that, and then basically you're mirroring to your final VREF here. So how does this work? Well, we know based on the loop equation, this current in here is PTAT. And you have a diode voltage here, and a diode across the resistance gives you, so this is PTAT over R, VPTAT over R. And then the current in these 13 megohms are diode over R. It's the 13 meg. And you weight these properly, and you're summing a PTAT over R and a diode over R, and then you're dropping it across an R. So the R's ratio out to a constant, and you end up with a VREF that's based on the PTAT and diode weighting, but you're not forced to make them equal to the bandgap voltage. It's inherent in this, but there's a mirroring ratio that occurs. Basically, you can scale the output to whatever you want right here. So I am going to go into this structure in more detail. The other thing I wanted, so again, many different methods of doing that same structure. But they're basically all based off of that paper. Then and that was Toshiba. And in 2006, I worked at TI at the time. Sanborn and Ivanov here, which let's see here. So I'm mixing up my eraser. And anyway, Sambor and Nivenoff, they have this paper, and it's based off of a principle developed before them called the reverse bandgap principle. Again, it allows for a lower voltage version of the bandgap. So the structure looks something like this, as you have, and I'll go into this a little bit more probably later too. So this structure is quite a bit different. It's not intuitive when you're first looking at it, but basically you've got amplifier here, and you're feeding back to a current that you're forcing into this structure. You've got an 8-to-1 ratio there, or whatever ratio you want. This is kind of like a VBE multiplier structure, and I'll get into later kind of what the equations are around this. But this, they produced a very low noise reference here. I think it was 190 millivolts without any off-chip capacitors. So this structure, it's kind of MOS-free here. You'd have a MOS feeding back for this current source here, but it's kind of a common mode effect, and there's not a whole lot of gain from that. So in your load resistors here are real resistors. And then there's different structures. I'll probably talk about chopping for flicker noise at some point as well. But I just wanted to say, you know, if you got high voltage, the original Brokaw cells, kind of hard to beat. Change my brush here. Kind of hard to beat. Bamba is used a lot for low voltage. This is a newer one, Sanborn and I've enough. And I'll get into these two in a little more detail, but I just wanted to kind of sketch out. These are both low voltage designs. This is kind of industry, you'll see this one a lot. This one's fairly recent and probably covered by patents and things. So anyway, that's a general look at kind of the state-of-the-art structures. So I'll spend some time here on the Bamba et al. Structure. It's a sub-1 volt band gap reference. Again, very, very useful. I'm going to kind of change my topology. I'm going to start writing diodes here. These can be done with this diode here. Can be done with a PMP in a CMOS-only process, and you can actually make those out of a PMOS device. So here's a PMOS device, P-plus diffusions, your gate, and then it's got N-well, and then there's a P-minus substrate. You have an N-plus contact to the N-well. So this particular P-plus would be the emitter of the PMP. This N-plus contact going to the N-well would be the base. And then the collector would be the substrate. So you need, you know, substrate contacts here that are collecting the current. So you can make this this out of a PMOS device. Most standard PMOS libraries have this already laid out without the gate, and they extract it so you can get you know, an LVS clean chip based off of the actual layout of the PMP. Let's see, I'll erase this. This is, and I'm drawing it like this because the thing about that PNP is the collector goes to substrate. And if your substrate's ground, then you pretty much need these diodes. You need the cathode side of the diode, which is the collector of the PNP going to ground, because there's nowhere else for it to go. It's got to go to the substrate. There's no isolation for that. So I'm drawing these to ground. So what you do here, so let's just take an example. I'm going to draw some MOS devices here. And they're acting as current sources. And I'm going to take these two points here and take them into an amp and drive this loop. So the amp, again, has high gain, and these two MOSes are matched. So these two currents are matched coming down. So what this amp's going to do is drive this voltage equal to this voltage, and then it's also going to force the same currents down these two paths. And that's our PTAT loop there. Because the voltages are the same, we can assume that those are basically connected, and we can write the equation around that loop there. And so you get the same equation for this structure as you do the regular PTAT loop. What we have here is we get the VPTAT voltage over, we'll call this R1 like we had before. And this is our current. So this in itself, if we mirrored this with the same size device here and here, MOS device, and then we shoved it into a resistor, we'll call this R3. So all these currents are the same because these are all the same matched current source. What you would get out here is you would get VPTAT over R1 current times the R3 here. So you get a PTAT voltage reference here. So this is one way to do just a PTAT voltage reference, and it's the, you know, 2 times the, it's the, that's our 54 millivolts, right? 52, 54, whatever you are going to use in your hand calculations. So 54 millivolts times the ratio of two resistors, and these are matched. So we can scale R3 bigger than R1 and get gain. You know, we could, if this were 10 times R1, then we would have 540 millivolts out here. So we could have a 540 millivolt reference here if this was 1 megohm and that were 10 megohm. Okay, so that, we're going to use the same thing. We're just going to add a couple more resistors to this structure. So we're going to take a resistor here and a resistor here. And remember, these two points are equal in voltage. We're going to call that R2. And then we notice that, oh, we have a diode here. And that diode voltage, VBE, is across R2. And that's the current flowing here. So the amp is still forcing these two points equal. It's still forcing these two currents equal. The currents in these two resistors here and here are the same. It's feeding back to equalize these two in the PTAT loop. And so you end up here with this VBE current plus the VPTAT over R1. That is the current I now. And then again, we mirror it over here. And we dump that whole thing into R3. And now we can scale. So we have a diode-based current, a PTAT-based current. We need to weight these and scale them such that we cancel, we get the same type of weighting we would have done if we did the Broca cell. But here we don't have to build the Broca cell. We don't have to have the PTAT plus the diode in a stack. It's done current mode. And so there you don't need all this headroom to do it. The other one output 1.2 volts, you couldn't, or 1.25, whatever, and you couldn't change that. This one, it's based on currents, and then you can scale it up by choosing whatever R3 you want there. Now, R3 can only be as high as your supply here, so if you have a 1-volt supply, you could produce an R3, you know, you need a few hundred millivolts maybe for this. For low noise, you might need 400 millivolts headroom on that. So you could potentially do a 0.6 volt reference out here. So this there's, you know, all kinds of ways you do to build this amp. Again, the flicker noise here is a problem. Can be a problem if your design's sensitive to flicker noise. So you can use physical resistors up there. There's many things you can do.
I won't get into all that detail. I did want to shift over and look at the Sanborn and Ivanov structure next. All right, I'm going to talk about the Sanborn and Ivanov structure. So this was a 2006 publication, pretty recent for Bandgaps. Bandgap's been around a long time, and this was actually a very good improvement that was done. It's a sub 1 volt reference again, so like the Bandba et al. Design, it's suitable for low voltages. first, I wanted to talk a little bit about kind of how this came about. If you're, break down the band gap into our V diode voltage, and let's just use nice round numbers, 0.61 diode drop. We add to it a 0.61 VP tap. We get our 1.22, maybe a little higher to get the magic voltage, and we're set. So if somehow we could come in and divvy this diode up into equally spaced pieces and only take one of those pieces. So let's say we divided this into 12 pieces, and this little piece here was 1/12 of a diode. It's got the same temperature characteristics of the full diode divided by 12. Likewise, we do the same thing here. We take 1/12 of our VPTAT reference, and it has its same temperature characteristics. So if you take this little piece here, this little piece here, and we add those together in a couple voltages, we still have the flat response, but we have 1/12 the voltage, so our 1.2 is now a 100 millivolt reference, and it's temperature stable. So we don't have to get the 1.22 if somehow we can do this. And so I'm going to kind of show how that's done. The first thing I'm going to do is go over a concept that's been around for a long time. It's called the VBE multiplier. So for the VBE multiplier, I'm going to say I have an R1 and an R2 here, and I shove a current into this structure. And I shove enough current that VBE is on. If you shove in a tiny current and this never, if this is only 0.3 volts, then this base emitter voltage never turns on. You never get collector current. So let's assume that, let's say, to get 0.61 volts across that VBE, we're shoving in our 54 nanoamps here. And so if we put in a little more than that, the rest of that is going to start flowing down this branch here. So we're going to get a current through this branch. And what we have here is we have a diode drop right here, or VBE drop here. And let's say we make R2 equal to R1 divided by 12. Then the current that's flowing here is the diode over R1. And then we're dropping it over R1 divided by 12. And we end up with the diode voltage divided by 12 here. So effectively we're multiplying. You can use this to multiply up. If R1 was equal to R2, this would be two diodes. Where it's useful in a lot of designs, say you wanted a 1.5 diode reference. So how do you build that? Use the multiplier here. And R2 is half the value of R1, and you can get 1.5 diode drop here. So that's the concept of the VBE multipliers. You get a resistor across one of the VBEs, and you take the current from that, and you dump it into a smaller resistor or bigger resistor to scale it up or down. So let me erase this, and then I will talk about this Sanborn Ivanov reverse bandgap structure. So they point to a Widlar paper and another paper as kind of being reverse bandgap references. Let me get this erased. I haven't heard the term other than their paper, so I think they coined the term, Sanborn and Ivanov did, but I'm not sure on that.
So let me draw the structure and then hopefully I can talk through it here. So we've got and I'm going to draw it a little bit simplified from what they have. I'm not going to include this resistor in here right now. This is our area of A. I think they use a 24 to 1 area. I'm not going to draw the 24. Just saying this is an area of A. I don't know what they call these resistors. I'll call these R, and I'll call this R1 and R2 there. I don't remember what they use. And then you got an amp here, so a high gain amp, and essentially let me draw it in terms of MOSFETs here. So this is a bipolar input amp for low flicker noise, and then a MOS low, but I'm just going to draw it as an amp, and then I'll just draw the MOSFET here, PMOS, and there's your, let's say that's a 1 volt supply. And then, of course, that's ground. Okay, so this right here looks like this VBE multiplier. So we're going to have a current I here. First of all, the loop is going to force the same current here and here. And that's because it's forcing this voltage equal to that voltage, and these resistors are the same. And we could weight those, I guess, to run different currents, but right now we're just going to assume we have the same I flowing in here and there. So this I produces a VBE here. So I guess it's VEB here. It's a PMP. And that's your I'll just call it VBE over R2. And so this current flows here. And then this can be scaled whatever you want. So it's R1 times VBE over R2. So again, if R1 is R2 divided by 10, then this is 1/10 of VBE. So this you can make very small, but it's a diode voltage. So from ground here, we go up a diode. A partial diode here, and then if we go up a VBE, down a VBE, running the same current and weighted with A, we see we have, this is our up and down is going to give a delta. So this becomes your output. The delta here is a PTAP. So a PTAP. Because this is going to be your, if this were 8-to-1 ratio, then the up and down would give you a net up of your 54 millivolts. Now they have a higher 24-to-1, so it comes out to be something else. Because I think they targeted 190 millivolts here. If we just, for now, we'll just stick with the 54 millivolt. So if we have 54 millivolt of PTAP, and then and then essentially we're having a VBE here, but we need this scaled down. So again, this is scaled down maybe by this factor of 12. That's why I've chosen the other designs. I'm just trying to keep things consistent. So when you put these together, it's a 1/12 version of the band gap, which in this case would be 100 millivolt. So they do their design a little different with the weighting, but that is basically how you're producing a partial diode here, plus the PTAP that's not scaled. Remember in the real band gap, we had to scale this up to, because we only had a diode, we didn't have a fraction of a diode to work with. So we had to add it to a diode, so we had to scale this portion up to get the weighting properly to hit the the VGO of 1.22. And in this case, we're targeting, you know, VGO over 12 or whatever. So that, in a nutshell, is what this structure is doing. They call it the reverse bandgap principle. The early Weidlar paper uses some, it's not a structure like this, but it's kind of got the similar flavor to it. But again, I think the reverse bandgap terminology might have came from the Sanborn Ivanov paper. Okay, this is the last segment here. We've gone over 2 hours here, so probably need to wrap this up. I did want to go through kind of our real-world full transistor level design here of the low-voltage Bamba et al. Style cell. So I'm going to assume I'm on some kind of BCD process, bipolar CMOS, DMOS, and I have a decent bipolar, and it's got a beta that's greater than 30. So it's a pretty decent bipolar that I can use as not only the core structure, but an amplifier as well. So if I have this device, I'm going to definitely use it. I'm going to try to stay away from the MOS devices as much as possible until I get enough gain because of their flicker noise. So I've got the basic structure here. I guess this R2, R2, R1. We talked about how to set those values up. Right here, I want to equalize these 2 points. And if I have a decent bipolar transistor, I'm going to use it as an amplifier here. So I've got a diff pair that I've created here as my amplifier front end. This is a 1, and we'll say this is an 8x8 device. So I know I have one diode up here. If I go with, I don't know, a by-2 device here, by-2 device here, and a resistor, let's say here, R4, I guess we don't, I haven't used R3, so R3, I know this is going to run a PTAT, because again, instead of natural log of 8, I only got natural log of 2. Then I do have some PTAT voltage across that resistance. So this is a pretty well-defined current. So I can certainly do that. What I might do is, so I could use MOS devices up here. I'm going to go ahead and do that for now. But these definitely will dominate the flicker noise, and then I may need to come up with resistive loads up there, but first I'm going to do this full structure with the MOS devices. So definitely this is probably going to be the dominant noise source here, the one flowing into the one with the resistor, because it has higher gain. Remember, this is 3 little RE here, whereas this is little RE, it's lower impedance. So that flicker noise device is big. Plus the one that, the biggest one is probably the one here that flows into the final. I guess that was R3 in the design, so I am going to call this one R4 down here. So the way to do the polarity, figure out what kind of polarity I need to drive the currents here, is you start with very low currents here. You say, okay, I've got very low currents and they're matched coming in here and here. Well, when you have low currents going into a by-8 device and a by-1 device, the by-1 is going to be a higher voltage. And so when we start off with tiny currents flowing in here, the by-1's going to have the high voltage, and we need to drive more current. So if this is high and this is low, this base is high, we need to drive more current in the loop to increase this and get it up and going. So this is high, we need to pull down on this. So you would create, I'm going to use PMOS again here. So these are PMOS devices. When this is high, you're pulling current here. So you want to tie that to there. So why do you do that? Again, you got small currents coming in here. This side is higher than this voltage. You want to So the diff pair has more voltage here than here. So this current is higher than this current. And then this current here gets mirrored. So the net effect is a pull down on this node. A pull down on this node will produce more current here and pull the entire this point up farther. Now, let's say you went too far. You pulled this up too far. Then at the balance point, these two currents are equal. But if for some reason you started with very high currents in here, then actually this would be higher than this voltage because you've got a lot of current flowing through this resistor here and there's a big drop here. So that means that this device is on more current's flowing here, and that would pull this point up, reducing the current. So that's your negative feedback. And I've got a lot of arrows in there that I probably need to get rid of some of these. Some of these signs. Okay. So I've got my bipolar diff pair front in here. I do have, of course, that goes to the supply. So again, maybe this is a 1.5 volt supply. We can run this down to 1 volt. Certainly this would all fit into 1 volt. So we're gonna size these. I think I can't remember, this is 13 meg and 1 meg. And then out here, I don't remember what we had. Was it a 5 meg? Yeah, because I think we ran 100 nanoamps here. So if we build this design and we come out with too much noise at this point, we can certainly do the RC filters to reduce the noise. But if if we're worried about flicker noise, then you may introduce chopping. So you could, I'm not going to introduce chopping there. So these devices have pretty low flicker noise. The ones you need to really reduce are right here. However, this one here, there's not really a chopping technique for that one. So this one still might dominate your flicker noise. And in that case, you could throw a lot of area at this device. Because your flicker noise is basically something like this. And this is... this would be the noise here at the gate, and that translates into a current through the GM squared of the device. So the noise at the gate, so I'm going to say voltage noise squared here, is the flicker noise parameter over, I think, CX squared. I usually just call that K. And then 1 over WL, and then times 1 over F. So that's your 1 over F noise. So as frequency goes down, especially as this goes lower than 1, this term starts blowing up. So that is the voltage on the gate. And then, of course, you multiply that times GM squared and take the square root of the whole thing to get the current here. I'm not going to go into details about that, but I just wanted to throw out just a thought process there. The other thing I haven't done is I haven't prevented the zero state on this right now. And the other thing is I haven't done anything about stability. So this is a high gain. I erased part of that. So this right here is the high gain node of the loop. This is typically where you'll compensate. With a compensation capacitor. So we'd put a capacitor right here to stabilize the loop. It would go to the supply in this case because this point, you always want to bypass wherever the DC voltage is referenced. So right now, if I were to take this 1.5 up to 1.7, well, this voltage remains the same. So that's where you want to put your cap. You never want to put your cap, say, to ground here, because then when this goes to 1.7, this is moving up, and then that's going to charge that cap. So noise on here is going to end up producing charging currents to charge that cap. You don't want that. So essentially you want to always bypass in the direction of where the DC wants to track. Back to the startup circuit. So a typical startup here is you need to pull current out of this node here. And I'm just going to say what you might do is something like this. You'd make a huge resistor here. You might drop a couple VGS here. So let's say we're at 1 volt supply. We've got a couple of diode connected MOS devices. The rest of these would just be in series, like a linear resistor to this point. So the point is you want to make a very big resistor here with just FETs, because FETs are going to be smaller than a resistor, more than likely. You could just use an enormous resistor there. That current burns all the time, so you got 1 volt here. You do want to drop a few diodes. You have a diode connected VGS here, and then the rest of it's a resistance. So in order to reduce that current, which is burning all the time, and it really serves no function other than to supply current to the startup, you want to minimize that current, so you want R to be big. So that does produce a current here, and you could go a 1 to M here. That way you've got a lot of current here to start. And then we want to cut this guy off. So we want to take this node here, and we would like to pull him down. Once this VBE here gets up, we'd like to pull down on this. It's still going to burn current here because this is going to be shunted to ground. But at least this one will be off and it won't mess up our circuit. We definitely don't need current coming in here. It's going to create an offset to our circuit. We want the circuit to bias itself. We only want this on if the zero state is occurring. So you could just simply tie that there and then size this device up as much as you need to pull down that node when you got a diode drop here. So if you were, if you're, 0.25 micron and below, this technique would probably work. If you were at half micron, then the threshold here might be more than the VBE here. So you would never be able to turn this on to pull down this node, and that's critical for the startup. So what I did here is just kind of go through thought process about putting in some final devices for the amp. So this was that gain of 8 amp. This is our high impedance node. It's where we would compensate the loop. You'd need to go through a loop stability analysis, and you could cut the loop. You could cut the loop here and inject a voltage here and look at the phase margin at this point here. So that's one way you could do that. Certainly lots of other aspects you could go into. Again, I've been over 2 hours here. I'm going to follow up with other series, so looking for input of what people would like to see. I'll talk with various people. I hope that this was beneficial. And if you want to read more about me, my website, again, I'm Ray Barnett, a website, nanoanalog.com. And this is, of course, posted on YouTube for free. And I'd like to just start spreading knowledge. And the way I do this is, again, it's like a napkin design. It's like you're just sketching on a napkin with some buddies. This is what I've done for years. So I've been doing chip design for 25 years now, and I want to be able to share my knowledge with a lot of people out there. So anyway, thanks for joining, and please visit the website.